Welcome you all class 12th in classroom notes by Rekha Jain. And today we'll again start the chapter Indigo by Louis Fisher. Line by line I'll explain the chapter in original text with word meanings. And before I start, let me again remind you to subscribe my channel if you have not yet done, and do press the notification icon to receive my latest videos, and also share the video so that a majority of the students study through here. So let us start the chapter. Yesterday we have done up to the point where Gandhiji received a written order to leave Champaran and he refused to obey, and that he gave in return by signing. As a result, Gandhiji received the summons to appear in the court next day. That means because he had showed disobedience to the highest authority, he received the orders to appear in the court for the next day. All night Gandhiji remained awake. He telegraphed Rajendra Prasad to come from Bihar with influential friends. He sent instructions to the ashram. He wired a full report to the Viceroy. So dear students, see the modus operandi. The whole night Gandhiji kept working, and next step he opted for calling Rajendra Prasad to come from Bihar with some influential friends, some powerful friends, and simultaneously he also sent some instructions to ashram what to do, and he telegraphed a full report of what happened with him to the Viceroy also, and everything was done in written. Now by the morning the news of his arrest has reached far-flung areas, and farmers from different parts of the country had reached to Motihari. And Motihari was black with peasants. They did not know Gandhiji's record in South Africa. They had merely heard that a Mahatma who wanted to help them was in trouble with the authorities. The spontaneous demonstration in thousands around the courthouse was the beginning of their liberation from the fear of British. So when the news of his arrest spread, Motihari was black, means Motihari was filled with farmers. Gandhiji was a great personality. His contribution in South Africa is remarkable, but poor farmers were unaware of that contribution. Because they had merely heard that Gandhiji was a Mahatma who wanted to help them, had himself fallen in trouble with the authorities. And their spontaneous, that means voluntary demonstration, their voluntary protest in thousands around the courthouse was a proof that it was the beginning of their liberation, their liberty from the fear of the British. The officials felt powerless without Gandhiji's cooperation. He helped them regulate the crowd. He was polite and friendly. He was giving them concrete proof that their might, hitherto dreaded and unquestioned, could be challenged by Indians. Now see the power of a common man here. Gandhiji, with his support, with his mass support of the poor farmers, showed the strength of the common Indian man, and only he could help the authorities to control the crowd by his polite and friendly language. And this was a concrete proof, solid proof, that their might — their refers to the Britishers' might, might here means strength, Britishers' strength — until then scared and unquestioned, now that was prone to challenges by Indians. The government was baffled. The prosecutor requested the judge to postpone the trial. Apparently the authorities wished to consult their superiors. Now seeing such a huge crowd, government was confused. Baffled here means confused and scared. And the government lawyer, prosecutor here means government lawyer, requested to postpone the trial. and this was a clear proof that authorities wanted to take the advice of their superiors. Gandhiji protested against the delay. He read the statement, pleading guilty. He was involved, he told the court, in a conflict of duties on one hand, not to set a bad example as a lawbreaker, on the other hand, to render the humanitarian and national service for which he had come. He disregarded the order to leave, not for want of respect for lawful authority, but in obedience to the higher law of our being, the voice of conscience, he asked the penalty due. Now he acted very cleverly. Gandhiji acted very cleverly. When the prosecutor requested to postpone the trial, Gandhiji protested against that postponement. And he confessed that he was guilty. And he accepted that, yes, he was involved in a conflict of duties. That means in the juxtaposition, like he disregarded the duties. He was in a dilemma, actually, why he was sandwiched between two options. Because he broke the law of disobeying the highest authority, that doesn't mean that he wanted to show his disregard for the authority. Why did he disobey? Because he obeyed for the higher authority of his inner self. Because he had come for the service of the humanity. And that was the inner call of his conscience, which he listened to, which he gave more weightage. And that is why he accepted his fault and he asked for the penalty due. That means he asked for the punishment. The magistrate announced that he would pronounce sentence after a 2-hour recess and asked Gandhiji to furnish bail for those 120 minutes. Gandhiji refused. The judge released him without bail. Again, this is a clear proof that the authorities were helpless before such a silent force, because magistrate announced that he would pronounce, here means announce the sentence, means punishment, after a 2-hour recess. And for these 2 hours, Gandhiji was asked to pay the bail amount. But Gandhiji did not pay, he refused. And when he refused, judge made him free without the bail amount. When the court reconvened, the judge said he would not deliver the judgment for several days. Meanwhile, he allowed Gandhiji to remain at liberty. Okay, after 2 hours, when the court restarted again, the judge announced that he would deliver his decision after many days, and during this period Gandhiji was made free. Now Rajendra Prasad, Brijkishore Bahu, Maulana Majrul Haq and several other prominent lawyers had arrived from Bihar as per the instruction of Gandhiji. They conferred with Gandhiji, that means they consulted with Gandhiji. What would they do if he was sentenced to prison? Gandhiji asked. Why? The senior lawyer replied. They had come to advise and help him. If he went to jail, there would be nobody to advise and they would go home. What about the injustice to the sharecroppers? Gandhiji demanded. The lawyers withdrew to consult. And Rajendra Prasad had recorded the upshot of their consultations. They thought among themselves that Gandhiji was totally a stranger and yet he was prepared to go to prison for the sake of the peasants. If they, on the other hand, being not only resident of the adjoining districts but also of those who claim to have served these reasons should go home, it would be a shameful desertion. So when Gandhiji asked ki if he would be imprisoned, what would they do? Then senior lawyer replied, if Gandhiji would go to jail, nobody would be there left to advise them. They would also go home. Then Gandhiji reminded them about the injustice done to the sharecroppers. What will happen to them? And Rajendra Prasad was, he had recorded the upshots of their consultations, of all their discussions. And they thought that when Gandhiji, now they realized, and their own conscience pricked them. They grappled with their own conscience and they started thinking and they started feeling guilty conscious. Why? Because they thought that Gandhiji, being an outsider, was ready to go to prison for the sake of these reasons, and they were the residents of the nearby districts and they claimed that they were the well-wishers of these peasants. And if they go home, that would be a blot on their honor. Shameful desertion means shameful departure. Means that would be an insult if they go back home. They accordingly went back to Gandhiji and told him they were ready to follow him into jail. The betel of Champaran is one, he exclaimed. Then he took a piece of paper, divided the group into pairs, and put down the order in which each pair was to court arrest. Now, after consulting with each other, they went back to Gandhiji and told him that they were ready to support him. They were ready to embrace imprisonment. And Gandhiji was very happy because he understood that they were united then. And unity is strength, and they in groups, they were divided into pairs, and they made a written statement to be ready to be court arrested. And Gandhiji announced that half of the battle was, even full battle was won. Several days later, Gandhiji received a written communication from the magistrate informing him that the lieutenant governor of the province had ordered the case to be dropped. Civil disobedience had triumphed, the first time in modern India. Now see students, this is the result of unity. This is the proof of unity. Seeing such a huge crowd and Gandhiji's adamant nature, authorities felt helpless. And Lieutenant Governor, who had filed a case of disobedience against Gandhiji, withdrew his case. This Gandhiji received in return, and that was the moment of extreme happiness, that was the moment of triumph of civil disobedience for the first time in modern India. Now Gandhiji became more confident, and he along with lawyers started conducting a detailed inquiry into the grievances of the farmers. Grievances means problems. Depositions by about 10,000 peasants were written down and notes made on other evidence. Documents were collected. The whole area throbbed with the activity of the investigators and the vehement protests of the landlords. Now this was the unique style of Gandhiji. Whatever he did with proof. So what he next step he opted for, that he made the peasants write down what torture and extortion was done to them by the Britishers. Why? Because he wanted to produce the solid proof against the Britishers. And during this activity, during this proceeding, the whole area throbbed. Means so many farmers, so many peasants, investigators and other important lawyers were present there. So this area became busy, hub of activity, and they started protesting against the landlords vehemently. In June, Gandhiji was summoned to Sir Edward Gate, the Lieutenant Governor. Before he went, he met leading associates and again laid detailed plans for civil disobedience if he should not return. Now, Gandhiji was called to Sir Edward Gate in June, and Sir Edward Gate was the Lieutenant Governor. Before meeting him, he gave the instructions to the to his leading associates and prepared the detailed plans how they will disobey the authorities in case he would not return. Gandhiji had four protracted interviews with the Lieutenant Governor, who as a result appointed an official commission of inquiry into the Indigo sharecroppers situation. The commission consisted of landlords, government officials, Gandhiji as the sole representative of the peasants. Now see, a special committee was made after the four long interviews with Lieutenant Governor, and there were three representatives, one Gandhiji on behalf of farmers, landlords and the government officials. Now Gandhiji remained in Champaran for an initial uninterrupted period of 7 months, and then again for several shorter visits. The visit undertaken casually on the entreaty of an unlettered peasant in the expectation that it would last for a few days occupied almost a year of Gandhiji's life. Now see students, initially when Rajkumar Shukla met him, he thought that his visit there would be for a brief period, but astonishingly that was a long visit of almost 1 year. Start initially means in the beginning it was continuously for 7 months, and then again for several shorter visits. So Shukla, who was uneducated, on his request he had to remain there. The official inquiry assembled a crushing mountain of evidence against the big planters, and when they saw this, they agreed in principle to make refunds to the peasants, but how much must we pay, they asked. Now when the committee was made and the inquiry was done, the crushing mountain of evidences against the landlords were found, and they had to accept their fault, and they asked Gandhiji how much money should they pay. They thought he would demand repayment in the full of the money which they had illegally and deceitfully extorted from the sharecroppers. He asked only 50%. There he seemed adamant. Writes Reverend J. Z. Hodge, a British missionary in Champaran, who observed the entire episode in close range. Thinking probably that he would not give way, the representative of the planters offered a refund to the extent of 25%, and to his amazement, Gandhiji took him at his word, thus breaking the deadlock. Now these planters were scared that they would have to pay full 100% payment of the money which they had unlawfully and dishonestly taken by force from the sharecroppers. But he just asked 50%, and he was very strict over that. He was adamant, he was very strict over that. And this was quoted by Reverend J. Z. Hodge, who saw the whole proceedings. Now one of the representatives of the planters offered to refund 25%, and Gandhiji agreed over this 25% refund. Everyone was surprised. Why Gandhiji agreed? The reason is given in the next paragraph. But when he agreed, the deadlock, the standstill was broken. This settlement was adopted unanimously by the commission. Gandhiji explained that the amount of the refund was less important than the fact that the landlords had been obliged to surrender part of the money and with it part of their prestige. This is the reason Gandhiji agreed to 25% refund. Because he was concerned about the peasants' fear, psychological fear, which was imbued deep into the minds of the farmers. He wanted to remove that fear. Money was not important. And the planters had behaved as lords above the law. Now the peasant saw that he had rights and defenders. He learned courage. Means farmers got self-confidence. He retrieved his rights and he became courageous. Events justified Gandhiji's position. Within a few years, British planters abandoned their estates, which reverted to the peasants. And with their departure from there, indigo sharecropping also disappeared. And the land, the real owners of the land, got their land back. Who were the real owners? Only the Indian farmers. Gandhiji never contented himself with large political or economic solutions. Now here, students, before this, Gandhiji came to Champaran to solve the problem of sharecropping. But he was not confined to a limited cause. His concern was limitless. He saw the cultural and social backwardness in the Champaran villages and he wanted to do something about it immediately. And for this, whom did he appeal? To the teachers like Mahadev Desai, Narhari Parikh and two other young men who were the disciples of Gandhiji. And Gandhiji's wife and his disciple's wife, everybody was involved in teaching. And several other volunteers came from Bombay, Pune and other parts of the land. Devdas, who was the youngest son of Gandhiji, arrived from the ashram and primary schools were opened in six villages of Champaran. And Kasturbai taught the ashram rules on personal cleanliness and community sanitation because hygiene was not, they were not aware of the hygiene. Health conditions were also miserable, very bad. And Gandhiji was lucky to have a doctor who volunteered his services for 6 months. And you see, students, because of the lack of resources, lack of money, whatever resources were available there, Gandhiji worked for the medical problems of the people. Three medicines like castor oil, quinine, sulfur ointment were given to the people. Who showed the corded tongue was given a dose of castor oil. Anybody suffering with malaria fever got quinine and castor oil. And for skin eruptions, for skin disorders, ointment plus castor oil was given. This was how Gandhiji's resourcefulness is visible. Now Gandhiji was concerned with the hygiene condition, hygienic condition of the area. And he noticed that women were not dressed up cleanly. They were dressed up in filthy clothes, dirty clothes. And that is why he asked Kasturba to talk to the women. But when Kasturba talked to them, they brought Kasturba to their homes. There was no there was no box or no cupboard, and only one sari. That is why only one sari means such a deplorable condition could be seen there inside their huts. What to talk about the clothes, or what to talk about the other facilities? These women had only one sari. They didn't have the second sari to change. So how can they maintain the cleanliness? During his long stay in Champaran, Gandhiji kept a distant watch on his ashram. See the farsightedness and the versatility of Gandhiji. When he came to Champaran, that didn't mean that he neglected his ashram. He kept in touch with his ashram also, kept giving the regular instruction by mail, and asked for the financial accounts also. Once he wrote to the residents that it was the time to fill in the old latrine trenches and dig new ones. Otherwise, now see, students, people were so unaware about the hygiene. Only he had to give the instructions about such minute things. This was how Champaran episode was a turning point. And initially, that was an ordinary thing. Whatever he did there, he thought. But he declared that British could not control him in his own country. In Champaran, he went for a different cause. He did not go there to show his defiance towards the highest authorities. He went there to reduce the sufferings of the poor farmers. And that was the typical Gandhiji pattern. His political efforts were combined with practical problems, and whatever he did was not a loyalty to abstractions. It means whatever he did was absolutely clear. He did not do anything for the sake of his reputation, just to record or maintain written documents. But he wanted to show his loyalty to the living beings, and he tried to shape a new free India, an independent India. Now, one English pacifist who was his disciple, whose name was Charles Freer Andrews, who was a staunch follower of Gandhiji, and he came to Gandhiji to bid farewell to him before going on a tour of duty to Fiji Island. When he came to him, because India was preparing for the freedom struggle, so one disciple of Gandhiji suggested that he could take the help of Charles Freer Andrews in his freedom struggle, and their freedom struggle efforts would be easy. And Andrews was also willing, but Gandhiji vehemently opposed that. Why? Because he said that we Indians will not show our weakness by taking the support of an Englishman, and we must learn to depend upon ourselves in our battle. And Rajendra Prasad commented that he had read our minds correctly, and by refusing the support of the English pacifist, he taught a lesson of self-reliance, and self-reliance, Indian independence, and the help of the sharecroppers in Champaran, all were intertwined. This was how Champaran episode became a turning point in his life. This is all in today's video, and I pray to Almighty to keep you away from the coronavirus, and you are also very alert and conscious citizens of India. You will keep yourself hygienic by washing your hands regularly. We'll meet again with the question answers of this chapter. Till then, bye-bye.